early years of the Brenton Puppet Theater, because we have this amazing occasion of having a bunch of early puppeteers, geezers, from the 1960s in New York City, where Brenton Puppet and where Peter began his art practice and Brenton Puppet was founded. And the way, should I just do a quick introduction of everyone before getting started? Jules Rabin, I'm just going to say names and then you'll get the swords later on.
Why don't we say our own names?
Okay, say our own names. So what I want to do is I want to give a quick, actually I'm the moderator, let me do
this. In other words, know your place.
We're going to keep things moving along here. So I'm just going to introduce my names and then everyone is going to totally have an opportunity to introduce themselves and how they found themselves to be working in Brenton Puppet. And it would be great if also we could get kind of a description and anecdotes and not only of work with the theater, but also of the political and cultural context of New York City, the Lower East Side, in the early through the 1960s. And so everyone will definitely be able to pitch in and tell their autobiographies and everything like that. So we have here Jules Rabin, Peter Schumann, Helen Rabin, Margot Lee Sherman, Amy Trumpeter, Elka Schumann, and Dee Dee Halleck. Okay. So, and what I want to do is I'm going to do a quick kind of chronology from when there's Elka and Peter land in the U.S. and then take you into the early 60s, at which point people like Dee Dee and the Rabins and soon after Margot, Amy start joining in, and then it's all their show. So this is partly, I referenced the Stephen Breck's puppet theater book from family stories and memories and stuff like that, but I probably won't get everything right. But feel free to correct and stuff like that as I go along. I'm gonna try to just race through this. So in the spring of 1961, Peter and Elka with two kids arrive from Europe, Germany or Austria or something like that. And they stay at Elka's parents' house in Ridgefield, Connecticut, which is about an hour from New York City. And Peter starts making sojourns into the city and discovers the Living Theater space on 14th Street, Merce Cunningham has a studio above that. He's introduced to different people kind of in the cultural scene, like some of the people who will make up the Judson Dance Theater, including Yvonne Rainer and Simone Forte, and Mora's teacher,
Steve Paxton
and people of that nature. And in the autumn of 61, the family moves to New York, and I don't know if it's directly to East 4th Street, but they end up in East 4th Street, where first?
6.
Between C and D.
WD is 6th.
East 6th Street, but then soon after moved to 4th Street.
No, the 4th Street first.
After we came back from Putney.
No, I'm talking about before you went to Putney. We haven't gotten
there. 506
East 4th Street. I'm talking about the autumn of 1961.
Shit, they told me wrong.
East 4th Street between C and D, they move into, they end up in an apartment of that formerly belonged to Klaus Oldenburg, whose career was quickly rising, and the super of the building was this guy, Dickie Tyler, who had on the same block the Uranian Alchemy Players, which was a group of ex-cons, drug addicts, and former something. Anyway, a group of very interesting, colorful group of people, and they would do spontaneous movie music making and performance. And Richard Tyler had actually founded the Judson Gallery, which was a part of Judson Church, which was a notable kind of a haven for avant-garde art practices as well as peace movement and activism and stuff. And they founded the Judson Gallery in 58, and in 1960 they organized the Ray Gun Festival, which was the first kind of festival of happenings that included Red Grooms, Jim Dine, Dickie Tyler, Klaus Oldenburg, Alan Caprow, Bob Whitman, and other notables, early performance artists from the early 60s. Then Peter ended up recruiting the Alchemy Players to be the performers in this first performance which was a staging of the Totentanz, or Dance of Death, which he had originally done in Germany, and recruited the alchemy players, and they performed it at Judson Street Church with, it's a mass performance that, actually, this is all, you should all be taking notes, because I understand that Adam is going to be playing movies.
Yeah.
Tomorrow night. And you'll see some of this stuff in real life.
There's some Totentanz stuff in that.
Right. And actually, the play was reviewed by the Village Voice. Again, I'm getting sidetracked, let me go quicker. But they performed the Totentanz several other times as part of the general strike for peace, which was organized by the Living Theater, and introduced them to probably the War Resisters League and other activist communities, activists in the neighborhood. And then in the fall, Elka got a gig teaching Russian. She got a job teaching Russian at the Putney School, her alma mater, replacing one of her former teachers.
Stefan Giurasi, the former, who went on sabbatical.
So she got this Russian language teaching class, and Peter proposed to the school to be the dance instructor, and they had seen the Totentanz perform there and said, we'll have no part of this. So instead he said, well, I can do an after-school workshop with kids doing puppet theater, apparently out of the top of his head. And thus was formed the Putney School, or the Putney Puppet Theater, also referred to as the Putney School Puppet Theater. And they would do shows, including, actually the school would actually let the kids go on the road, and they went to some different colleges, including Harvard and other places, and there is a bibliographic record of that. So that's early on. That's all before Brendan Puppet. Along the way, Peter's doing other puppet performances, sometimes called large puppet workshops or instructional things. I forget the thing. Anyway, and there's a whole bunch of names. There are several other names that come out. The People's Puppet Theater, the Live Puppet Theater, and in the summer of 1963, from Putney, after the school year is over, Elka stays in Putney to continue her graduate studies at Wyndham College, and Peter takes a Jeep and with a trailer that turns into a self-styled theater and live workspace that is mobile and can travel, and starts traveling around New England and staging improv puppet shows in small New England towns. And he's encountered by Bob Ernstall, who is a young Brown college student who sees Peter struggling mightily trying to do a solo show all by himself, and he offers to help him, and Bob becomes kind of Peter's first American collaborator in puppet theater after the Totentanz people.
They were
called the Muzak Puppet Theater at that point. And then, 63, in the fall of 1963, then Peter gets 148 Delancey Street, which is Daughters of Red Groom's former studio, and he opens there the Bread and Puppet Museum and starts staging puppet shows, and the practice of giving out bread starts around that time. And joining into the company are people like Bob Ernstall's already there, Charlie Adams, who was with Dickie Tyler's group, the Alchemy Puppet Theater, joins in. Eva and Bruno Eckhart, who are fellow Germans, also join in, and Bread and Puppet officially, or not officially, unofficially, starts doing its performances and stuff like that. So, take it away. So I'm curious. In Stefan Buck's book, he gives approximate dates for when people started actively performing in the theater, but I know that people encountered the theater prior to them performing in it and were friends and colleagues and stuff like that. But in his book, he references Bob Nichols, who isn't with us anymore, as starting around 64, Helen and Jules Rabin coming in around 1965, Andy and Amy Trumpeter coming in around 1966, Margot Sherman coming in around 1966, Mabel Dennison, who's no longer with us, coming in around 1967, but I know that Dee says she knew the theater back when we were still living on 4th Street, which must have been around 65. So why don't we start with Dee Dee and you talk about how you came upon this and others.
Okay. I was living on 4th Street and also, but for on Avenue B, and you were further down. And I met the family through Gretchen Muller. And I had a boy, Ezra, who's now sort of part of the theater land, if and not anything else. Our children were sort of the same age. So we went to Tompkins Square Park together and played on the swings and the slides. And occasionally there would be concerts and events in Tompkins Square Park. I was interested in film even very early, and in 61, there was a theater, the Charles Theater, that used to show films. And if you brought a film can on a Tuesday night, I think, they would show your film. So there were, Jack Smith brought some films that Ken Jacobs made. It was an amazing crew of experimental filmmakers and artists who were living. It was a real neighborhood, the Lower East Side. Although we were sort of invaders, there were a lot of Puerto Ricans and Ukrainians who had lived there for many, many years. But and I had known Red Grooms, and I had been in some. I went to some of those happenings at that Delancey Street before. And very early on, when you moved to Delancey Street, there we started doing children's. They were from Russian fairy tales, and yeah. My children were went to that, and Ezra, Peter, and then later I had Toby, and there were the first of the Peter's performance that I saw was, aside from these children's shows, was St. Dan's. It was the Last Supper, and that was really striking. It was the puppets are up in the barn. in that Last Supper scene, but I just want to it was such a time of family life that I really remember more than
anything. Well, we had the kids,
yes, and the children playing together. And
who else was there for the kids' shows besides you and your kids?
Peggy Leo,
right.
Would bring Melissa Leo, who's a famous actress now, and her son Eric Leo would come. Whenever there was a show, you would be there.
Yeah, but it was only those few families, and one day there was a strange gentleman who looked too nice.
Yeah,
who was that? And then he gave me a summons. I had to go to court at one of these performances. It was just for these few families. And I had to go to court and for performing without a license. And the judge just
laughed in the face. But there was Mary Nichols brought her children there too, I remember.
Yeah.
I remember there.
The Nichols kids.
Yeah, the Nichols kids.
And the Brecht kids.
Maybe
that was later.
They were younger, yeah.
Helen and Jules, how did you first encounter the theater?
I think we saw the Mr. Miller's stories in the Hudson Gallery.
Wow.
And I think then very quickly we got involved in the Easter story. But I can't say what year.
Right.
No, but I think you were also the Mary
in
the
Christmas story.
Story,
but what, was that before the Easter story?
That was in 63, right after Putney.
That's a funny story.
But I wasn't the first Mary.
Eva
was the first Mary, and then...
Oh, yeah, maybe.
Eva, and then Elka, and then you. And the strange thing about these...
Eventually Solveig.
That was way later.
So the three first Marys were all of them pregnant. They were looking for a place in which to have a baby. And
it's by the red cast.
I gave birth about 5 days after.
You gave birth?
It was very close. Hannah was born on the 4th of January. I think we had the last Joe was the last day or to, you know, a couple of days before the new year. So it's very close. But but the Easter story was before that, and it's hard because I wasn't doing any puppet shows after that.
Do you remember where that was?
Yeah, in the church on, in the Lower East Side, on what street?
Six or seven. Brick building.
Yeah.
It's where Joe Puppet started the Shakespeare Company. That church, you get the name.
Yeah. Anyway, that was where I learned how to try to move a puppet. So slowly.
Slower, Helen. Slower.
The Mr. Miller stories said, according to the book, had started before. I think in Putney before Bread and Puppet, and then continued into Bread and Puppet's show.
Well, that was my first seeing. But did you see the Totem?
I saw the Totem Dance, and that was after my first contact was with the Mr. Miller story, which was played in a little room in the basement of the Judson Church.
Called the Hall of Issues. It was called the Hall of Issues.
But such a big title for such a little space. I remember there were movable wooden benches there, and I came in as a stranger. I lived close by in the neighborhood. I stopped in, and the show never began. And I became a little irritated. There were these guys, I don't know what you would call them, hobos or hippies, and there was a quart of beer, big beer used to come in big bottles like that, and it was being passed around. And I finally, with an official outsider's voice, said, "Look, it's half an hour after you're supposed to begin." And Peter said, "We'll begin now." But that was the first I saw, and I became interested, and then my interest had developed with the Totem Dance, which was a much bigger scale, and it was, I don't know what, it was continental, it was European, and we were intrigued with the idea of the Totem Dance, a dance of death, at that time, 1961, because the world was going crazy with nuclear weaponry, and nuclear weapons were being tested in the atmosphere, which meant the very democratic poisoning of all new babies throughout the globe, because the strontium-90 would circulate from the stratosphere to every continent and every island. And I felt at that time that a piece of theater called the Totem Dance, the Death Dance, I don't know what motivated you, Peter, to create a piece of theater like that, but to me it spoke to that time when we still have nuclear weapons, but we are at least discreetly and politely exploding them underground, not in the atmosphere.
The first demonstration that I went to in New York City was with Grace, was there, and she got arrested there. Grace Bailey at the it was at City Hall, and it was against these so-called shelters. There are still a few little. You'll see that yellow sign with the nuclear sign on it. But in that era, everyone felt they should have a nuclear shelter
and fallout shelter.
And so I heard there was a demonstration, and I went, and that was the first time I ever saw Grace Paley, and she got arrested, and they put up a line, a clothesline, and they said, whoever wants to get arrested, stay on this side of the line. And I was on that side of the line, and Grace came up to me, and she says, honey, do you want to go to jail? And I said, no. She said, then get out. So I thought, I didn't get, and I always regretted that I didn't.
There's still time.
Marga, tell us how you first encountered the theater.
Oh.
What's your...
Yeah, I was with my boyfriend at the time, who was a grown-up. I was 19 or 20. And he was the only person on the theater staff of the Village Voice that liked Bread and Puppet. Yeah. And he took me to see all kinds of great stuff at Chuck's and etc. And one day we were walking through Washington Square Park. And into Washington Square South suddenly appeared a very small motley group of people, three or four people. I hated America and everything American, shiny, new, etc. And these were eight old.
Say louder.
Say louder.
Oh, just to explain that I hated all superficial American, modern everything. And then I saw this small group of people and everything about the way they were dressed and everything, say it not, was old. The masks were not pretty. They were not shiny. They were not trying to say, look at me, I'm so beautiful. They were different, they were old. Charlie played the trumpet. The other people maybe hit a bass drum. There was one person, I had no idea he had ever studied the violin. He played one tune, I heard that same tune for decades. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
Who could that have been?
I swear, God, I get very carried away. You see, this is what I had been looking for my entire 20 years. Because I was brought up in the theater and I hated that whole culture of unite, you know, I could get into the whole thing about the propaganda and the stupidity. And as Elka says, that whole generation between 45 and 60 was called the silent generation. People were so afraid. The House on American Jews can explain about that. And suddenly, something that was old, it was medieval, it wasn't trying to sell itself. And then I knew I had found what I had been looking for my entire 20 years.
And then how did you get involved in the theater? Like, how did you start participating?
Oh, so Arthur, the man I mentioned, he began a theater of his own on St. Mark's Place. And a guy who was helping finishing the walls and the floors, you know, we had to invite people to perform there. And he said, you should invite Bread and Puppet, they're good. So we went one hot summer night and saw Fire on Delancey Street. It was very sweaty and we stood in the back and it was incredible. Then so we invited Bread and Puppet to the Bridge Theater and they performed, as I remember, Leaf Feeling the Moonlight and Kingstar. And then a while after, it was the Christmas Story and Helen was pregnant with Susie. And I said to myself, this guy must be a genius. Mix pretend with real. Donkey, the side of a donkey. Blanket. Jules is probably underneath like this.
You a donkey.
Oh, then someone else is a donkey. I mean,
look at something. Practicing for life.
Of course you were Joseph, I'm sorry.
Oh, Joseph, that's right. That's right. Joseph, it was my
Someone
baby.
Someone else was. I always said it. I thought to myself, this artist is a genius. Who else would mix real life and pretend? And it's so beautiful.
And so then how did you get involved?
I'm sorry. So there was a woman in the company then named Catherine Merrill, and she was very beautiful. And I was very jealous. And she was a potter, and she worked with Bread and Puppet. So I went to the pottery studio to see if I would do that. And I didn't like it. And she said, Margo, you should work for Peter. He needs you. And in those days, you just walked. The same week, Andy Trumpeter just walked.
Which show?
Well, the first thing we're doing was Scholastic, you know, of course.
Say that again?
And
Scholastic.
Oh, making puppets from Scholastic, okay. Which you have to dip into acetone and put over the clay. And in our naivete, you know, nothing about illness. Oh, isn't that funny? Acetone, you could get cancer. I think the first thing was the Fifth Avenue Peace Parade of March something, 1966. And I have a few photos. And then, of course, it must have been the Easter show, the crucifixion. And the first amazing thing I noticed about this show was that the seamstress here, someone would get into one of those apostles upstairs, burlap, and he tailored the burlap costume around by using a staple cut. I had grown up with a million thread. So I guess I was in that, and then I was in the Christmas Story, and all those parades in those days. And you know, by parades, we don't mean what you do now. These were peace parades, peace pageants, peace demonstrations, and peace shows. Everything we did was related to the war.
And then you said that Andy and Amy came in for the same...
I came in a different time than Andy.
You came in a different time than Andy. So tell us about your introduction, because you said that you came in also in a Scholastic-making capacity.
Yes.
Or Scholastic, whatever.
So I went to Delancey Street and saw Fire and was overwhelmed with the beauty of that piece. And also saw the Fifth Avenue Peace Parade, which changed chanting into a mystical experience watching Vietnamese women with a giant airplane like bombing demon over the top of heads. And it was a traveling parade so that the women who were blindfolded went to the ground and the big shark demon airplane, as that airplane flew over them, and then when they rose up and walked forward, it could be repeated that the demon airplane went over them, and the drum beats again made this bombing. And those two experiences were so right, and the times with the Vietnamese War were so hard to know how to grapple with. So I know I left a note on the door of Delancey Street saying I want to work with you, but that wasn't a good enough way to find the theater. And Chicken Little happened in the Bronx, and someone might talk about that who did it, so I missed that from not just finding them. And when I saw an ad in the paper for Angry Arts Festival, which was the Living Theater and several other theater groups and Bread and Puppet. Bread and Puppet was making a Grey Lady cantata to Bach's music cantata Rise Up, and they needed lots of the Grey Ladies who you see in the museum, and the invitation was to come to the Public Theater and Scholastic these masks, and that's where I joined.
Mom and Pop and maybe Jules and Helen, do you want to talk about the summer workshops in the Bronx, South Bronx, Lower East Side, Brooklyn? Jules was there, and you talked about it as well. Where Bread and Puppet got a commission to do public performance workshops with local kids, dealing with local issues, if you guys want to talk about that.
First
that
was in East Harlem, the earlier one.
The first one was in East Harlem.
Uncle Fatso's.
We built Uncle Fatso. We had it was a failed summer program by Spanish Catholic Action, was the organization. Huh. And that was on 100th Street between 1st and 2nd Avenue. It was called the most crowded block in New York City. So it was so full. But the kids could never get out of this block because of gang wars. So the kids were always stuck on the block. Uh-huh. One street over was another gang, and the kids were not allowed to go there. Uh-huh. So we were confined really to that block. in that street. We built under fence, we built about 50 rats. We built cardboard high-rises, tenements with little hand puppets in them, and we performed an anti-evil landlord play in the street in that block. And Uncle Fetzer was the big evil landlord. And later on, people always told us, oh, he looks exactly like Johnson. And when Nixon came, he said, oh, he looks exactly like Nixon. Was always identified as looking exactly like Uncle Fetzer.
And Jules documented that on film, which is probably some of what I'm showing. Jules, what are your, and was it, it was over two summers, 65, 66, and I thought you were employed by the Parks Department.
I was not directly Parks, one was a council for Parks and Playgrounds. The friend of Bob Nichols, Carl Lynn, an architect who worked with the Council for Parks and Playgrounds, he had gotten us into that, got a foot in the door.
And Jules, you documented
Yes. Your memories? I worked as one of the puppeteers, as one of the, I don't know if we monitor the kids, but, you know, there are a bunch of kids sort of bored and rambunctious between the two. And there were six or eight of us colleagues of Peter, appointed colleagues by Peter, who did basic puppetry work. And, you know, I think I was exempted from performing. I worked in the workshops, I did some carpentry, and there was a guy, by the way, Arnie, who was a very good carpenter, who helped to build, who did build some of the giant puppets. And maybe that was the pattern or basis for some of the giant puppets of the future. This was experimental at that time. And I think, Peter, you thought that I had enough carpentry skills so that I could build them, but I quickly gave way to Arnie, who was much more competent than I at that kind of work. But we... No, I want to say that this is an experience for me, who has known Peter for, you know, more than 50 years now, maybe 60 years. And the names of all of these people you mentioned, I wanted to mention Bob Ernstall before. Yes, to Elka, and, oh Christ, I've lost my battery. I wanted to mention a guy who was associated with Bob Ernstall at that time, Beanie. Beanie was Bob Ernstall's buddy. Beanie quickly disappeared from the theater. Bob persisted for some time, and then, strangely, terribly, Bob died some years ago, not so many years ago. But at any rate, I want to say that I've been in and out of the theater. We've all been in and out of the theater, some in more than out. But what a panorama of memories, all of these people who are mentioned. We touched the lives of so many people, and you know, it was a rich time, and it continues to be a rich time. I look at Genevieve there.
Yeah.
Everybody knows Genevieve. I met her first in Paris, I think, in 1976 or something like that. We had the first serious talk about life in Algiers. Was it on a beach? Was it a resort? We were put up at a resort a little bit out of the city. But our lives are studied, those of us who participated and were in and out, in and out, in and out, myself and Helen were out the man. But what a, it's more than a bundle of memories, it's more than a sheaf of memories. It's a whole constellation that we mention all these names from olden times. And I see scattered around here people like Susie Denison, who since she was just about born. Now she has Now that I'm talking about...
No, you're going into the 70s, but Susie was born in the 60s. But you met Jennifer Gavin in the 70s. Did you do the children's shows in Delancey Street?
I remember doing, standing behind the curtain and doing hand puppet shows.
Did you create them? Because you did children's theater later.
I think I did a little bit, but...
Yeah. He's nodding your head. You said you did create them.
We worked on the puppets together.
Russian books, you know, Russian kids' books.
So you're
a collaborator. It didn't last very long, the children's theater pieces, but I know that was an idea to start to do kids' shows and bring it.
Was it hand puppets?
Yes.
Hand puppets. Do any of them still exist in the museum?
No.
And just talk about what your impressions of those early, you know, of those early years, you know, when these people started coming in, meeting the Rabins and the Denisons and Margot and Dee Dee and the theater thing.
The Delancey Street was a walking distance from our apartment, so I'd go there pretty often but mostly I was taking care of our kids. So,
and we would stop by the Essex Street Market.
Yes.
And get some pickles.
And Jules was a truck driver at that time. And one day there was a honk in the street, what is that, Suffolk Street? And Jules stood on top of his truck, that was the height of where our loft was, to say hi. Remember that?
I remember seeing that.
But I remember going to the demonstrations, because they were either walking distance away or a subway ride away, and I didn't participate because I had a baby carriage to push and two little kids by the hand, but I went to as many as I could and carried Stop the War signs, and they were very powerful, those both the number of people who came together for this one simple, straight purpose, and then also the puppet part was very strong, so that...
And there's a wonderful photo of you with the kids, and I think Mark's on my back at one of these demos, aiming his toy gun.
Actually, the face, a lot of the masks were made from a woman, Li Min Mo, who was actually my babysitter, and who had been a pottery student at the after-school program at Henry Street Settlement, where I lived and worked. And Peter somehow met her. I took her to the theater and asked her if she would do a life mask, and she did. And then her face became the face. She is Chinese, actually, but became the Vietnamese and Cambodian.
I actually cast her five or six times. Yeah. I cast her face in different expressions.
Yeah. Yeah. And she's in the museum now.
Use the negatives to make the masks.
And she became a storyteller, and she has written her autobiography, and that's self-published, and she goes around L-I-M-I-N. Mo, and she does storytelling and leads storytelling workshops around New England. She lives in Cambridge.
So when did the Delancey Street finish and the move? Was the next move to the courthouse?
No,
Shakespeare. Delancey Street finished when the landlord upped
and then the courthouse.
When he upped the rent. The rent, usually Bob Nichols paid the rent for the next.
It was $68 a month.
Yeah. And then he wanted to up it by $5, and he thought he couldn't afford that, so he quit. We had an offer from the...
Joe Pat?
No, from the church first, the Spencer Church in Brooklyn. So we stored all the puppets there. And then Joe Papp invited us in the unfinished Astor Playhouse. And he gave us a whole floor there. And that was huge, wonderful. Mm-hmm. That's where we learned to know your husband, Sebastian and Sarah, and the Brechts, they came
Yeah, there were a lot of children's workshops.
Can you talk about when Mabel taught?
Earlier than that.
Do you many remember? And I, my memory is that Mabel paved the Delancey Street from family folklore. No?
Not Delancey.
Not school's park first. But then we learned to know Mabel. I don't remember the date, but Mabel came up to the Nancy Street. It was a VW bus, and we had to transport something. She just gave us the key to the bus and gave us the bus. Just like that. Typical Mabel.
Both Margo and Amy talked about the Fifth Avenue Parade in 1966 that you saw it. Which parade, which demonstration parade was the one where there were those famous photographs of with the napalm baby doll? Was that the same one?
No.
That was later,
no,
because Margo was in that parade.
66.
Yes.
He had just made a terrible statement, which Françoise has here in French, and we decided that we should do a vigil.
Let's reinterpret what you said. It was in London. Cardinal Spellman was the big Catholic cardinal in this giant church. What's it called?
St. Patrick's.
St. Patrick's. And he had blessed B-52 bombers on their strafing missions to North Vietnam.
Yes.
And when we learned that, we decided to give him a bloody Jesus as a present for Christmas. So we bloodied a doll and brought it to the steps of his cathedral, and all the place was full of that behind.
With mass performers, with mass people in mass.
Oh, here.
No, but people can actually wear the mask.
Here,
no,
I found some pictures from it.
Yeah, no, it was very interesting because either Jules or somebody had alerted the ACLU that we wanted to do this. And the ACLU advised us not to wear masks. So we worked overnight all the masks and the things that were above your head, where your ID was still visible.
Uh-huh.
And when we arrived, the cops were awfully embarrassed because they so much wanted to arrest us.
Yeah.
But the reason was gone. They were all there with handcuffs and so on, you know, white woman. And we kept out of the gun. We put on our ado, and their faces were there under the mask, so they couldn't do it.
Yeah, there was a law against wearing masks in public.
Yeah,
it went back to the Indian days.
But they stole the baby, right? Really?
Well, no, we deposited the baby at the foot of the. They didn't let us into the cathedral. We deposited it in front of the door, and then an FBI agent snuck it out.
They put it in the lost and found. Or someplace, a big
department
store. And I think the department store never saw anything so crude in all its great existence as that crude baby made bread and puppet fashion. I didn't see it in the store, but it certainly was inconsistent with a whole sheet of that very expensive department.